Okay, at this time, at 6:06, I'd like to call the meeting South County Emergency Medical Service SCEMS into Board of Oversight into session. Chair Bob Ahern has reported that he will not be able to attend this evening, so let's go in case somebody has a, keep going. Okay, first on the agenda is approval of the minutes of our last meeting.
I'd just like to make a correction to the minutes. I'm not listed as attending, although I am quoted in the minutes.
What was that last?
I was not listed on as attendance to the meeting.
Oh, okay.
Although I was quoted in the minutes.
You were here.
Yeah.
And I'll piggyback on Carolyn and say, I don't believe I was here.
You weren't here.
No, you weren't here.
So.
The meeting went a lot quicker.
Yeah.
We went there out by 6:30.
I am more than welcome to, repeat performance.
Oh, yes. Baseball coming up.
Exactly.
Okay, so.
Where's your son, by the way, in signups? I haven't seen him. Who's that?
Cut it out. I know, I'm so bummed. I want to watch him.
Oh, you're the dad?
Yeah.
Oh, my Lord, we have to talk.
So, Jonathan Edwards, you are not here.
I was not, but I was with you in spirit.
I appreciate it. Who else was not here?
I don't believe I was here.
Everybody else was here. Jonathan was not here.
No.
I wasn't here.
But you're not listed either.
Right.
Yeah, you're not here. Were you? You were here, weren't you, Carolyn?
Yes.
Trevor wasn't.
I was not.
Yeah, Trevor's not listed.
Okay, yeah.
Maybe that's how come we had such a quick meeting. I thought it was Jonathan and you, Trevor.
I tend to hog up the minutes.
I know. All right. So, we'll have correction of the minutes. Jonathan Edwards, we'll scratch him. Because it says Board of Oversight members in attendance.
Mm-hmm.
So you're not really a voting member. How do you want to be recorded?
I'm a fiscal agent, so
okay.
I can just say
she's like ex officio.
Okay, we'll say fiscal agent, Carolyn. How's that? Is that okay, Carolyn?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Okay.
Okay, can I have a motion on the corrections?
I make a motion that we accept the minutes with the corrections.
Second. Any discussion? All those in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
5-0. Zach, we're rolling.
Got it.
I can't vote.
Huh?
Can I vote? I can't vote because I wasn't here.
No, they changed the laws.
Serious?
Yeah. That you can now vote in minutes that you didn't attend.
Well, then I want to amend more. That's a silly change, but okay, whatever.
All right.
That's the town hall one. Is that my fault?
Joe Markarian produced a financial structure review of the South County EM and is here to make a presentation. Joe, your floor, my friend.
Well, thank you very much. My name is Joe Markarian. I'm an employee of FERCOG. And it might be a good idea for me to tell you why I did this. Prior to joining FERCOG in 2014, I was director of the Technical Assistance Program at the State Division of Local Services. And what we did, my team and I, is we would travel into towns and cities throughout the Commonwealth and conduct financial management reviews. And we would look at everything from financial management procedures to technology to organizational structure to pretty much everything to do with money. Money coming in, money going out, got checks and balances and so forth. I had done that for like 15 years or so. I've got prior experience in municipal government as well and state government. And my expertise is municipal finance. I work for FERCOG and if I were not there, I doubt that this report would have been done. It's just fortuitous kind of thing. I happen to be there, that's my area. Do you mind taking a look? I did. And what I did was, it's pretty self-explanatory what I looked at. I mean, I looked at your not so much your procedures, because those are the town of Deerfield procedures financially in terms of producing vendor warrants and conducting, completing payroll and so forth. And they do a pretty good job of that. I think that's, they have their systems in place. I think that Barbara Hancock and Brenda Hill are doing a good job. What I have talked about in here are essentially my observations. I have no background in emergency medical services, so what I wasn't coming from any kind of bias or knowledge. So there was a bit of a learning curve in trying to understand some of the aspects of it, but those weren't really aspects that I thought were important to what I was doing. It was just background. So what I looked at was just how things are done, and in particular the IMA, and whether there are some changes that might be made. These are just what I saw. There's nothing here in my report that is legally compelling. There's nothing here that you're obligated to do. You should take them as mere suggestions. I'm more than happy to go back and forth a little bit on why I saw something some way that you might see a different way. And quite frankly, if you said, you know, we've read your report, we don't agree with anything in it, I would say, that's okay, fine. And it's entirely up to you whether you think that any changes are warranted. And if you feel like things are functioning well the way they are and that no changes are justified, then that's why you're sitting in the seat you are, to make those kind of judgments. But I'm happy to walk through this, to talk about it. But for the most part, I think it probably would help if I assume everybody read it. If there are any comments and questions, go from there. And I know you have some comments and questions.
One of the questions, if I could, I'll start. One of the questions is not in your introduction. It says the long-established Deerfield Ambulance Service of Town Department was reconstituted as a South County EMS. That's factually incorrect. In fact, the three towns, each town disbanded their EMS service to form the South County EMS.
Wasn't aware of that.
So we basically, each town, and on the original Board of Oversight, Bobby Herner, who's not here today, Gary Stone, and Mark Russo were the EMS directors from the three services. And that was the hardest thing to overcome, and I've said this a thousand times, and I truly believe it. Gary Stone is one real reason why we are what we are today, because he was adamantly against it in the beginning. And Gary did, and I think that's the beauty of the whole South County EMS, is that people with divergent opinions were actually sat down at the table and were able to discuss things through. Gary tried everything in his humanly possible to maintain the Whiteley Ambulance Service. And I think today, if you asked him, he's probably the biggest supporter of South County EMS. And I think that's a key, that's one thing I would somehow, in your report, I actually like your report, except for that, because I think that should be memorialized somehow, and that should be going through it. So 50 years from now, when we're having the 50-year celebration of South County EMS, they'll remember that a bunch of people were able to sit down at the table with divergent views and actually form this group.
Well, and I'm going to piggyback on that for a second, Tom, because it wasn't just the factual incorrectness that troubled me. And what troubled me really has very little to do with you. It has to do with the fact that clearly, if that was your interpretation, it's a branding image, it's a branding challenge that this organization has, that it is, perhaps it is perceived in a widespread way as being exactly what you describe. And because what Tom said is accurate, we've worked so hard to make this a three-town initiative and a three-town operation, with the administrative tasks being given to the town of Deerfield. Because we've worked so hard to have complete regional cooperation, it worries me that it's not perceived by the public as just that. It should give us a task, perhaps, at this table, to figure out how to change the perception. Let's assume that perception is a rule and not an exception.
Mm-hmm. I mean, it's really hard when you start out the report and you read it and something like that jumps out right away.
Well, I can say to you, it wasn't a point of focus for me.
I know.
Yeah. Because somebody had mentioned as an aside, oh, this was a Deerfield department.
Exactly.
Right.
Exactly.
And so I just, nobody said, you know,
no, corrected.
Talk right. about what you're in. And that was not the point of my report. It wasn't to provide a history. It was just intended to be an introduction.
But it's context for us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's a kind of kick in the pants. Because it's not your fault, because I'm sure you're just talking to a person and we didn't have a chance to review. But there was a lot that went. Let's put this. There was a lot to get us to work. There was a lot of nights that we spent. Right? There's a lot of nights, and I think it shows what can happen. It truly can happen if you get people that sit down at the table and are willing to have a frank discussion about stuff with no holds barred. I think it's a good thing. And that's the only reason I think that was the process was a really great process. I just like that to continue. I'd like to, thank you, Trevor. I'd just like to capture that.
Well, and we don't need to belabor it, but I think it would have been a lot easier if Deerfield was in charge and we contracted the services, but we chose to put in the extra effort and to have the awkwardness and the extra work that entailed of having a truly regional service by having the three towns work together.
Well, but Carolyn, in all due respect, I would argue that if Deerfield had chosen that path, it wouldn't have happened.
Well, right. And I'm not saying it wouldn't have, Jonathan, but ultimately that it was an easier way to do it, and we chose not to do that on purpose. And so it is really important that somehow we change the report, because there was a lot more effort in working together than just some other way, you know. So
it's a better result.
Yeah, I mean it is a lot more work and a lot more headaches. So I think if Joe could amend that, that would be wonderful. I think
we can work. Joe, we can work with you, can't we?
Well, I'll say a couple of things. One is that I originally thought that I would be talking to each one of you during the course of doing this report earlier, and I actually decided against that. And I decided against that because people have different perceptions of what they feel, the way they think things should go, and I didn't want to get caught up in people's perceptions and expectations that way. I thought it'd be eventually better that I just do it objectively and get reactions. Clearly, that created this initial little concern that you have. I'm certainly willing to alter, you know, that introduction. But I'm not, unless you tell me that there's something in this report that, by stating it, is an enormous problem for you, I'm not inclined to change the content of the report otherwise. Is it so? Because that's
just
what we're asking.
Because
otherwise it ceases to become my report.
Right.
And
right.
It becomes what others want.
No, right.
And I don't think anybody's asking that.
Okay, no. Yeah. In the terms of the introduction, it's going to take more than what I've heard tonight to come up to redraft that thing, because it's, I'm going to have to sit down with somebody and just talk about it. And again, it wasn't my intent to provide a history of how things happened, but I understand your point about it. This is an opportunity to get to create some context to where you are today.
I'm just talking intro overview. Okay, the other thing you mentioned a few times in here about select board that may not necessary as you say, select board members from each town occupy all the Board of Oversight's positions. That's factually incorrect also.
That's what I was told.
By who? If I may ask.
Well, it doesn't matter.
Getting inaccurate information.
The town of Deerfield at the present time has three members of their board. Trevor and Kip are on the Board of Oversight. Carolyn is on our financial liaison. Gary Stone is a member, used to be the EMS director from Whiteley. Bobby Ahern is the EMS director, used to be the EMS director from Sunderland. And Jonathan and I are selectmen. So Sunderland has one selectman, one former EMS director.
At its inception, Deerfield had one member on this board who was a select board member, and Whiteley had zero members who were select board members.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it just, when I react, and I apologize if I react like by who, but it goes to my perception challenge. It frightens me that people out there are feeding information, consciously or not, that is just couldn't be more inaccurate.
All of you are non-selectmen?
Correct.
No.
Okay. I can't tell you precisely where I got it, but it was stated to me as a matter of fact kind of thing. Otherwise, I wouldn't have made a point of it.
And it concerns me that the comment was made in reference to the fact that the Deerfield representatives on the board are select board members, and so it magnifies my concern that it's seen as nothing more than a Deerfield department, which
it's not.
It absolutely is not.
And we are only temporary.
Yeah,
supposedly.
Well, we won't be
we
there
are
forever.
Already beyond what I envisioned, but
and don't get us wrong, the only reason we had selectmen, and it was a conscious effort in the beginning to have a selectman on, because selectmen were more familiar with the budgeting process and we had to sell it to the community. So it was advantageous to have a select board member on at that time. But to tell you the truth, we always thought that the Board of Oversight was going to be a more advisory, and we wanted people that had that EMS EMT emergency service background.
That's Whiteley purposely chose not to have any for that very reason. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
May I suggest, again, to get back to the introduction comment.
That is something I would want to correct in here. I mean, if there's factual areas, I don't want to let those
right.
go. I mean, that doesn't make sense to me. So that's another thing that we'll have to clarify and look at where those references are and make the change.
Great. If I can suggest, and then Trevor, I'm sorry, Zona.
No, go ahead.
Because it might be very helpful to Joe to give him, rather than him having to dig up, all of our past minutes.
Sure.
And minutes that took place from the public hearings that we held in creation of SCEMS. Because if you recall, Tom, I mean, I know you and I with Mark did a roadshow to all three towns when we worked diligently on selling this to all three towns. And those minutes, both from once the board got started, but also any minutes that may have been kept in public hearings, and I don't know if they are.
Yeah, I don't know.
That would be helpful for you in terms of understanding the history and feeling comfortable rewriting the introduction a little bit.
Joe, that's all. Believe it or not, that's it for my my critique. The bad part, the rest of the stuff I find pretty interesting. I have questions on it. That's why I get a lot of stuff highlighted.
Well, I do want to correct factual errors.
Yeah, I thought that was the easy stuff to correct. To tell mostly, I have questions about the functional aspects that you've written about inside here.
Yeah.
So when I go through it, you believe it appears that you would agree with our process of using it as an enterprise fund right now.
Yeah, I think so. My original thinking when I heard of it was that, geez, I'm not sure that works. And it was primarily because of the rate setting aspect of it. Because enterprise funds, those in control usually have control over all the rates, and you know, you don't. But given that it's a three-town venture, an enterprise offers the most transparency. It offers the most clarity in terms of revenues, expenditures, and where money's going, and so forth. So I think it is an appropriate vehicle.
See, and now, personally, it's funny because I'd always thought the enterprise would be the best way to run this also, but we had some people stating, was it the last meeting, Kip, where someone in the audience said that we're limited on how long money can stay in a certain account?
I can see that in the minutes. Yeah.
I don't remember.
And they said that's what the state had. Do you remember that, Karen?
Yeah, but you know what? And I feel bad because I didn't retain earnings. I didn't ever clarify that, so I felt really bad about that.
I've never heard anything about a time limit on the use of retained earnings. I've never heard that.
Well, because all of a sudden I was very concerned because a lot of times we're looking at I guess I have a question, and I think we every time we meet with our board, our finance committee, retained earnings do come into play, but I think it's because we've been using kind of retained earnings as our free cash, per se. But we put money there for our ambulance, our next ambulance, our next whatever. You totally take a different tack inside
of you. Yeah,
it's
just, I think the problem with a high level of undesignated retained earnings is that it's like having too much free cash. People begin to think that we're being overtaxed. Mm-hmm. It's a perception more than anything else.
It is a reality. We're paying taxes on something that we don't have a need for.
If there's no justification for retained earnings.
We'll agree to disagree on that.
I've been to the Deerfield Finance Committee, and that's where we've gotten killed every year. I think, Kip, I mean, you can maybe speak like or Carolyn or Trevor, but we always it appeared that they didn't have problem with how the process was being run. They had problem that we were asking for too much money,
right,
and we had so much retained earnings
because they didn't know the purpose of retained earnings.
Right, and there was a time,
and that's where that concern lies. If you think you're being overtaxed until you learn all the actual facts, as opposed to alternative facts.
I think people felt. Go ahead.
No, just if you learn the actual facts and why the retained earnings are at a level that they are, then you have a come to Jesus moment and say, okay, I understand now. It's not necessarily about being overtaxed. It's about understanding how the decisions were brought about.
I think as I kind of watched the discussion unfold, I was thinking that it was a lot of concern about, that amount of retained earnings. People were worried that it was building up, and why are we getting assessed this much when you have this much cash hanging around? But I think there was the nervousness on the board at the time of, we give all that back. It was too young of an organization, so they weren't kind of sure how everything was going to play out, where it all needed to go. And I think this year, and maybe as the next year comes along, people have a better idea, and that could actually drop some, or we find out where it's all used.
Well, what I was going to say is with this organization, the majority of our costs are pretty much fixed, and we understand that, and the majority of that is in labor. And the second large amount is funding of the ambulance. And that, as of July 1, 2016, we had $517,405 in the enterprise fund. As of today, if we close the business, we have $624,564 and $345,000 in a reserve fund. And out of that $345,000 is $285,000 for the ambulance, leaving a balance in that reserve fund of $60,000. So we basically have almost $700,000. That doesn't include any income for the last 2 months. That's only through the end of January. And also, all the towns equally have only contributed 3/4 of their assessment. So this is what I'm saying is, like, we have a history, even though it's short. We know what our fixed cost of labor is going to be and the expenses, health insurance and stuff like that. We know what the cost of these ambulances are going to be, and we've got an awful lot of money here, and it's approaching close to 75% of our operating budget.
Well, I was hoping, since Joe was coming, we could go over overtime costs, because it's one of the recommendations you had, was that we actually pull out overtime. We do need to adjust our call staff numbers, because we're not using anywhere near that. And so I thought some of that call staff money could be towards overtime. And then a recommendation of some sort for our retention. I don't, you know, whether it's 20% or whatever we could put. The biggest item we have is the ambulance. So if we have a capital stabilization account, which we contribute every year towards the replacement of the ambulance, makes total sense. And then our retained earnings or free cash amount would be like a 20% cap, so that our assessments to the towns could be adjusted.
Karen, could I hold you up for 1 second? I think those are all good points, but can we just stay on retained earnings? Can we just stay on focus on retained earnings? Because I agree with Kip and kind of where Trevor was, I think, was going also. I don't think we necessarily need $700,000 in retained earnings.
Right.
Zach had a pretty accurate portrayal of what he's going to be using for capital over the next 5 years. I saw his capital is kind of there. I mean, there may be a couple things that we wanted to add, but our big expenses every 5 years, 5 to 7 years, is an ambulance. But Joe, when you were looking at the numbers, where did that money come from for the retained earnings? Because we see how much we're setting aside as a town. I think we see in how much we got coming in. We got for the revenue. Where are we missing it in the budget process?
Well, I don't think you were. I didn't take a real hard analysis there. I did speak with Brenda about it and Zach about it. And in the first couple of years, the turn back is it's turn back of money that wasn't spent. So that was the on-call money in the first couple of years. And the revenues came in higher. I mean, I think that's primarily driving this, is that the revenues had come in higher than projected. But it wasn't a bad idea to keep your projections low, because if your revenue doesn't materialize, you're really in trouble. So that was, it's a learning curve. I mean, these few years have been a learning curve financially, and after this year, I think this year's is going to be a little bit different from what I saw, that the on-call budget, the appropriation, is pretty much halfway spent, halfway through the year, something like that, pretty good. In any event, it's being spent faster than in prior years. So that's a variable that, you know, is out there. But the revenue, we don't know what's going to happen with the revenue. I mean, you have to have a little certainty and about where it's going. And you know, Zach's point to me was about the Affordable Care Act and what kind of influence that might have on revenue. That, of course, may not take place for a couple of years, or if ever now, but it's something to keep in mind. It's all about having experience with your budget and just what you're comfortable with. And as I said, the retained earnings, you know, one of the funny things about an enterprise fund is you can budget a surplus. You know, and that surplus, I mean, goes right into retained earnings. So if you think your retained earnings are low, you can essentially create it, you can build it looking forward. So it's hard to pinpoint exactly. I don't think it's been the same every year as to what's fueled retained earnings. But I think there was the early years where there was a lot of money, and for the reason of that you were mentioning, Trevor's?
Yes.
And that the uncertainty of going forward, and you didn't want to be caught short, which I think is prudent. And as you get further into it, you try and make that budgetary adjustment. You look at trends, you know, you look at trends and where they are.
See, that's what I guess, you know, that's what I don't understand, Kip. I know your numbers are probably pretty accurate, because that's what we're seeing. And we've seen in the past, because our retained earnings have grown. But we, you know, I look at the expenditures. The expenditures looks like we're going to expend what we base in the call, and also in the full time, looks like we're going to expend more or less almost 100% on those line items. Your maintenance costs are pretty much the same. I mean, they're progressing. And most of the numbers that you've got, of the other numbers, the health insurance, the workman's comp, came from Deerfield. And I think you guys are getting really close on those numbers as well. So I don't know if our present budget is out of whack. I just don't understand. And I can understand us the first year, you know, like, you know, we said you were going to have, what, $380,000 of revenue, and we got 400 plus. So that was like a... No, we may have.
It's on the revenue side, I think, and.
Well, we were conservative because you don't honestly know, and so we were conservative in projection our runs and collections and stuff.
Yeah, and I think that's wise. And also keep in mind, just like free cash, retained earnings is cumulative. Whatever you don't spend rolls into the next year. And when it's, it just, you know, it just, it's a lot of money to have there, that if it appears to people that it's undesignated.
Well, that was why I think it was really important to do a capital stabilization line item for the ambulance at least, because then you're pulling out that ambulance capital, this building, so that we have paid, you know, we're paying forward for that every year.
Well, how does that money, I thought that's what the reserve fund is for. Isn't that how the money gets from the enterprise fund to the reserve fund is set aside for the ambulance?
Well, the reserve fund is when you under budget. Like, for an example, this we are going to under budget payroll. We're going to have a shortage on payroll. So,
but that's primarily because of the overtime.
Right. So, we're going to, you know, you would use your reserve for that, you know, you would transfer into that line item.
So, Joe, excuse me, do you have a recommendation for percentage of budget in a reserve fund for what we operate?
I wasn't thinking in terms of having a retained earnings and having a sizable reserve.
Right.
I wasn't thinking in terms of those two pockets of money. I was thinking in terms of a reserve, much the way the Finance Committee has a reserve for unforeseen expenses. It's not a huge amount of money. It's maybe $50,000. Maybe it's, you know, $75,000. And that's your reserve, and that's an operational reserve. It's not for capital. It's an operational reserve for unexpected expenses. I think a stabilization fund is a good idea, a special purpose stabilization fund for an ambulance. And you can appropriate from retained earnings into that stabilization fund. And now you have a clear picture of what your retained earnings are. And if it looks like it's going to be increasing, then you give it back in assessment. You can always make, I don't know if there's a mechanism for making mid-year adjustments in assessments.
Special town meetings.
Well, we can do whatever we, I mean, we're pretty.
Yeah.
Would hypothetically, should we take because we haven't gone to the towns yet with our budgets? I mean, but should we put in a reserve fund to take $50,000 out of retained earnings and put it as a reserve fund?
Like a line item reserve.
Right.
I think that what would be useful is to speak with Brenda Hill about, I don't recall a reserve being, I didn't know there was a reserve. I looked at the expenditure reports, the monthly expenditure reports, year-end expenditure reports, and I didn't see any line item for a reserve.
We don't.
You don't have it, then what was this reserve that you're speaking about?
I don't know how it was created, that's why I just asked.
It was retained earnings from, I forget which fiscal year, but the decision was not to spend those retained earnings elsewhere, so they remained in the account as a de facto reserve fund.
There's a specific reserve fund, and I don't know how the money got there, but
it has to be appropriated into a reserve. There's no other way for money to get into a reserve.
Well, yeah.
So we never did. I don't believe we ever did that.
Right. My point being that money had been set aside, but it didn't end up.
What it sounds like is that it's part of retained earnings,
correct.
And it was in it, and somebody wanted to earmark it, which you can't do with retained earnings. Earnings are it's all fungible. You know, it's all money that can be spent on anything, and you can informally talk among yourselves that we're going to try not to spend X amount of money, but you cannot legally earmark. If town meeting wanted to spend that money, they could.
Right.
Yeah. So that's why you know, the notion of retained earnings and reserves are, you know, somewhat synonymous.
Hmm. So are you suggesting that at any one of our town meetings they could vote to spend the retained earnings of the ambulance service?
For ambulance purposes. only for ambulance purposes, not for anything else. But I'm just saying that if there was an ambulance-related cost and somebody wanted to buy two ambulances rather than one, and you say, no, we've set aside retained earnings for our building expenses, you know, when we have our new building, they could vote to take that money. You can't earmark retained earnings. That's why a stabilization fund, you know, makes sense for the ambulance stuff. And also this whole notion of line items versus articles is really important.
On that, so what you were saying, we could, it would have to be under town of Deerfield?
It would be in the town of Deerfield.
We could have a stabilization, a specific purpose stabilization for operation we could just call it South County EMS. And we could put a $200,000 number inside of there?
Usually stabilization funds are for one-time cost. You don't use a stabilization fund to fund operational costs. So that wouldn't be the vehicle.
But a recurring ambulance purchase?
Well, yeah, if you had, people will, it's a savings account.
Right.
And every year you're putting money in, and in year six or seven you take out $400,000 or $500,000, and the money keeps going in, so that 5 or 6 years later when you need $500,000 again, it's there.
It's there.
Creating a stabilization fund these days is a majority vote. Putting money into it is a majority vote. Getting money out of it is a two-thirds vote. But it would be a town of Deerfield stabilization fund, but it would be, if you set it up, special purpose stabilization funds are specific to a purpose and can't be used for any other purpose.
But so that I can get some clarity on this, it sounds like the creation and the expenditure of that fund is in no way the domain of two of the three towns that form this partnership. Deerfield could do it on its own if it chose.
Only to the extent that your current budget is. I mean, it still has to...
It should have.
Actually, I'm kind of confused because my understanding is that under an enterprise fund, you can have a capital stabilization.
You can't have a capital stabilization fund. You can't have a stabilization fund inside an enterprise.
You can't. Okay.
You cannot.
I thought we could.
Yeah. No, that's going
to be separate.
Yeah, that's been long-standing.
So how does the budget has to be approved by all three towns? Is that how it currently works? I'm sorry for my lack of knowledge.
So,
it does.
Yeah.
Well, it does have to, it says in consult, the budget's developed in consultation.
Right.
You know, with this board.
Yeah.
Which is always a term that I'm never quite sure what it means. But it has to be approved by... Well, each town has to approve its assessment.
Their assessment, portion of, their portion
yeah.
of that.
Right, yeah. But each town then has to approve any expenditure of stabilization.
I don't know what the vehicle... let me say it this way. Yes, in so much as the expenditure would be part of the budget, they're approving the expenditure, therefore they're approving the funding source, which would be the stabilization fund.
But you could have a mid-year, and I'm just hypothetically speaking here, you could have a mid-year. I'm just making sure that the town of Deerfield, and I'm not picking on you guys just
no,
have
go
to be
ahead.
The fiscal
sure.
agent.
Whoever is.
Right, making sure that the fiscal agent can't hold a special town meeting in X month and make a claim on that retained earnings for an ambulance purpose using your phraseology without consent of the other two towns, and it doesn't sound like that's the case.
The consent of the other two towns has to do with the intermunicipal agreement. If
right.
your language is tight enough so it says that, then you got to abide by your agreement. If your language does not say that,
sure
then it's
does.
A loophole.
Yeah.
That you don't want to.
That we need to fix.
Yeah, yeah. So maybe we could adjust right. the.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That
because we shouldn't
spell
yeah.
it
out.
It, obviously, it's all three towns' money. It
right.
needs to be spent the way
right.
the board sees fit.
Right.
Yeah.
And I can't tell you precisely what. I mean, I did read your agreement, of course, and I do remember references to the budget at this point, but it's been a while.
Sure.
And so I can't tell you exactly, you know, what it. what it says relative to mid-year adjustments, mid-year expenditures. It is, I would say, a mid-year expenditure is still a budget item. It still comes out of the category of budget. So the same requirements as on the annual budget would kick in. But you got to look at it and then determine whether it's strong enough for what you're trying to protect against.
So back to something Kip had said earlier and what you had said concerning retained earnings, okay? One thing is that we don't, none of us here want 700, I don't think. I don't personally want $700,000 in retained earnings.
No, I was just discussing the semantics of it.
I understand.
Yeah.
And that's if we, I don't think we have 700,000, do we? Well, I mean, if we closed shop today, but that's all planned for other stuff, right?
But
I think we took out the ambulance.
Oh, that's where the ambulance out.
That's the ambulance out. In other words, if we close today, all of our bills are paid, including the ambulance, and we still have $700,000.
Okay.
So I guess the question back to retained earnings that this Board of Oversight has to answer is that how it came about. And I think I understand that. I think personally that we haven't expended every single line item like normal budget, and we haven't budgeted our revenue. We didn't budget our revenue right to the nth dollar.
Well, the budgeting your revenue is going to reduce your assessments, right?
Right. So.
But I would rather have a lag myself. I think it's important to be conservative in our revenue estimations, because you never know, this goes in cycles, and you don't know when people are going to get sick. You don't know the mix of your insurance, private insurance versus Medicaid and Medicare. I think our revenue projections, we should be conservative, but I think once we made it through the year, when we can reduce our assessments based on what
past history.
Past history of what do we have in retained earnings.
Yeah, one way you might look at it, a lot of towns don't that have these kind of agreements don't assess in advance, and they sort of assess retroactively. The year has gone by, now we're going to assess what it costs and everything else. If you get through, and whether that's a good idea, I'm not arguing that one way or the other. But something like that, though, is when you get to town meeting, your accountant should have a pretty good idea, for instance, of where your free cash is going to be. The accountant's going to see where money's coming in and where it's going, what kind of line items are short, which ones are long, where the revenue is in relation to the estimates and so forth. Well, the same holds true here. And if you've got through three quarters of the year or 10 months of the year, you might have a pretty good idea of what your financial situation is, and you might have a provision that allows you to waive the last quarter's assessments or to reduce them or adjust them somehow. You create yourself that opportunity, therefore you're dealing with the reality of one fiscal year. And you can budget as conservatively as you like for the protections, Carolyn, that you're talking about. But there might be some mechanism that you can impose that allows you to do that.
Well, speaking on that subject, I think that it's kind of important to kind of bring this forward in front of this board, because, as the fiscal agent, we could at our town meeting, go ahead and have this argument, but I think it's unfair that we don't have it amongst the three towns. So I'd rather deal with it before we go to our town meetings. And I think this is a prime example we really should think about this and quickly, because we do have $700,000 and there is another quarter to be paid by all three communities. And even if we decided that the three communities didn't participate in the third quarter, we would still end up with close to $460,000 after the ambulance. So, looking at for our taxpayers, I mean, I think that's a prudent thing that we should really think about doing right now. I mean, because we've got that money, and like I said, that doesn't include any income that was, developed for the month of February, 2 months, or March, And like I said, all of our bills are paid up to date, and the money is already sitting there for the ambulance.
I'm not sure you need town meeting votes to waive your fourth quarter assessment.
No, I understand that, but what I'm saying is I'd rather have the discussion with all three of us right now, instead of, you know, us, you know, the Deerfield people doing it and saying, all right, look, we want to cut this, and this is what we're going to do. I'd rather have these folks involved with this decision.
Well, because you couldn't, the Deerfield folks couldn't do it unilaterally anyway.
Well, no, but I guess what I'm saying, Jonathan, is I don't want in 2 weeks when Carol and Trevor or I are, you know, debating about our budget, and I said, look, you know, we've got all this money, I want to cut this, and we decide, yeah, all right, we cut it, and then you find out
you don't
afterwards.
Want to, or something.
Yeah.
Well, I get that. Yeah. I totally
that's
get
why
that.
I want to have
because I can't, for the life of me, imagine the town of Whately ever going against a recommendation of this board.
Well, I think it's important to understand.
And I would hope that would be the case for.
But that's why, since our town meetings are all coming up. In
right.
It wouldn't be a circumstance like that. Because the money's already been appropriated for a whole year by each town.
Correct.
So the town meeting that's sitting in the spring of this year
really
doesn't have any say on what was appropriated last year.
I see.
It really is, I would think, if there's a provision in your IMA that allows you to waive the third quarter by this board, I think you could do it, because you're not appropriated.
Right.
You know, there's no town meeting action. It really has to do with what authority has been granted to this board. And I don't think anybody would argue with giving you the authority that we don't have to pay anymore.
Right.
You know,
actually, though, I think from a budget point of view, it would be easier for us to have a lower assessment for the coming. What we'd like to do would be lower our assessments for the coming year versus not paying, because we don't get that money until it's certified. So it's not available to us, and we have budgeting issues right now.
But it's interesting, because that may be a difference in the towns, how they would prefer.
Sure.
That's true.
And because some people want to see the free cash, nice big number in the fall, and that kind of thing.
Right.
And that's true, but here again, we're all going to be having our town meetings in 5 or 6 weeks, so as a board, we need to think about this, because we're only going to meet one more time before our town meetings, so.
And the warrants will be done.
Right.
Well, the warrants are going to be done at the end of the month.
So, for instance, Kip, if you would, please, if you one assessment, $78,575 about for Deerfield, $47,783 for Sunderland, and $25,445 plus or minus for what? So they are sizable. There are sizable numbers.
I did not.
But those are sizable.
About 100.
And if you told the town that you're not going to charge them that money, that would be available for the town to use.
Well, I think quickly, listen.
But if they could go back, you have to do it at town meeting, right? But you could use that $78,000 or whatever that amount.
But the numbers that you rattled off, I think, came to about $150,000,
something like that. Yeah.
So if we lowered the assessment, whatever our portion is for the year coming forward, that's about a 10% reduction. So we could change our assessments by 10%, and we would still have.
Can I make a different perspective? I'm not saying right or wrong. One of the things that concerns me, because the great unknown is revenue, going forward it always will be. I like the concept, off the top of my head, of being able to just not assess, because if we suddenly are reducing our budget request in a given fiscal year, if our revenues aren't what we thought they would be, and we all of a sudden have a uh-oh moment, because our budget, and we're forced to then ask for a number that's significantly higher than what's on the books because of the original cut, because we didn't have to, people on town meeting floor will say, wait a second, why are you increasing it by 25%, whatever that number is.
Even
and I think that's
number.
It's sort of like, I'm going to cut taxes for a year, then the next person wants to put it back, they're all of a sudden on the hook for a tax increase when it was just getting the money back to begin with. It's a semantics issue that I think we'd be challenged with.
Well, but I asked Zach, and this year, The assessment, I mean, the overall budget's the same as it was last year, about $1,153,000. If we cut the assessment to all the communities, instead of generating this 1.1 million, we'd be just generating 1 million. But we still have $700,000. So if next year worked out to be just like this year, we'd still have that $700,000 there. Or no, we'd have 150,000 left. We'd still have 550,000.
And I think Joe's suggesting that that number's a bit high.
It's still high. It is. But I, you know, if, I understand with what you're saying, what Carolyn's saying. I'm not saying cut it by 25%, but I think, you know, 10-15% reduce the assessment for next year would be a realistic goal.
Just to throw out one thing about these earnings, can we use some of this to outfit the new building? I mean, is that what we're planning
to use it for?
Well,
anything.
For anything?
Any of that.
Well, that was what
I had asked
Zach to make sure we put money aside for the ambulance. You know, when you have a capital stabilization, you would put in the ambulance, but we would also take out from the retained earnings and the amount for, you know, whatever Zach had come up with for the building costs, and so that we had furniture and all that kind of stuff. And that, because we do have the cash there, and instead of going to the towns for additional money, it would, and therefore you're reducing this, like, free money laying around.
So,
but, I mean, so everybody is so tight.
Do both.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Easily.
Okay.
Easily.
I was thinking we have $1 million budget. We should have at least 20% retained earnings, which is like 200,000. You take out for the ambulance, you take out for building expense, outfitting the building, then we still have quite a bit. So if, in my mind, if you reduced the assessments by 10 or 15% or 20% going forward, we still have all this capital money and retained earnings that are still, as we're going through and trying to have more of a track record.
And my only concern is if we were to reduce by 20% and we suddenly needed to ask for that 20% back when things aren't as rosy, that's a tough political hill to climb.
I get that.
Yeah, it really is.
If we take, if you just take in the fact that if we did get the other quarter of assessments from the communities, and the revenue from these past 2 months, that's an additional $225,000. So that $700,000 now grows to $925,000. You see how fast that changes?
I get it. I'm trying to prevent having to ask again.
Right.
Let's not do what so many people do and use rosy economic scenarios for our budget forecasting, and because it's dangerous.
But that's why I said we always do it a year behind.
Yeah, I know it was my idea, but I think to try and give back assessment, I would be a quick decision that wouldn't have the amount of thought that you'd need to go into it. I think that looking at next year when July 1 hits, it's much easier to plan, okay, this is what we're going to look to do, and this is how we're going to do it, because it's with town meetings coming up, everything's going to feel rushed, and inevitably there's going to be a question that pops up that, you know, that you just didn't anticipate. You know,
and that's an excellent point, Joe. My question to our board is, if you saw, let's say we reduced the assessment by 10% this year, 15%, say 15%, what would you say next year if the budget had to go up 15%? How would that go over in your towns?
Well, I think that if that did have to happen, then it would be very easy for me to say, look, we reduced it last year because we were making too much money or kept too much money, and this year we don't have that luxury. But I just don't see how that would happen. I mean, we this year also we were faced with about $140,000 in overtime that we were really trying to get a handle on, and I think now we have. So that's additional money, you know, and I hate to see that, you know, there's this big pocket of money, and now, you know, I think we're all pretty frugal, so I don't
but
want...
But it might be a good idea to try and wean yourself off
exactly.
rather than taking big chunks out. You
exactly.
Do 10% on a 10-year program.
Yeah, maybe, but 15, 20, that's a...
So
except that we're all paying less than what we were paying before.
So.
For the paramedic service, I mean.
So for discussion, do I hear a motion to reduce the assessments of the town by 10% for discussion?
I'll make that motion for discussion.
Second.
All right, let's have a discussion about reduction of 10% in our assessment.
You're talking about next year's budget.
For next year's budget.
Budget.
Is there a discussion against?
Well, let me ask you a question. Can you have that conversation in a vacuum and not include the other piece that Kip's describing? And I don't know the answer to that in terms of not asking for Q3.
Oh, no, I just threw that out.
Right, I get it, but if we're going to have a conversation about reducing the assessment for next fiscal, mm-hmm. it probably shouldn't happen in a vacuum with what else, without what else we could do. That, maybe I'm wrong, but...
Well, I think...
So Jonathan, can I just clarify? Yeah. You're saying just do the reduced assessment, not anything about whether we pay or not.
No, I'm saying that we shouldn't make the decision about the reduced assessment without understanding what we're going to or not going to pay in
okay.
Q3.
Okay. I'm assuming we were going to pay.
Support.
Because we all had budgeted.
I was assuming we weren't going
to. Oh. Well, no, because we all budgeted it. So.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, that's fair.
So you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
All right, so, yeah, so if we reduce the assessment by 10%, we're going to have to take some retained earnings and put that amount of money into a reserve.
Well, I'm not.
It would just stay there.
Or would we take that retained earnings and just increase our retained earnings to the towns by 10%.
I think when you say that you're going to reduce assessments by 10%, you're saying that you think other revenue is going to cover that gap. And the other revenue being
the
revenue materializes above your projections. So if your projections are equally conservative,
yeah.
and Zach has produced conservative revenue projections, then the excess revenue you get is...
So I would say that we'd be taking that... what's the number?
150,000.
That 150,000, we would just kick that from reserve, from our retained earnings into the projected revenue.
That's it. Would be a revenue source,
right?
For
that would be the revenue source. We can use it. We may not use it, but we would have it there in case we needed to pay for it.
Yeah.
But we're still skipping. Maybe I'm the only one
skipping a large amount of money that's in there.
Well, but if the budget is the same as last year, and how much ahead are we overspent on our payroll, Carolyn? I was getting at is if we do get this overtime under control, that dollar amount is equal to the 10% reduction in assessment.
That's net.
I think there's some confusion about these payroll numbers that warrants a discussion at some point.
Well, we do need to discuss them. Yeah.
So.
Oh, yeah. Oh. I've been harping about the payroll. I was worried. This is what we've spent today on overtime. It averages about $3,900 a pay period. So potentially for fiscal 17, it'll be just roughly, a little over 200,000. I mean, a little over 100,000. So Joe's recommendation is that we take an overtime, a specific line item for overtime, instead of counting that using the call staff as overtime. Because the call staff, we still have call staff that we spend, but we only spend, we've been spending less than half. And so, but if you combine all the payrolls, including Zach's salary, we still are going to have a shortfall in the payroll at the projected overtime of about $20,000, so $18,355 if you just averages all the overtime. So this is what I had talked about in September. It looked like we were going to be about $20,000 to $30,000 short. It still is projecting that way. So I was hoping that we could have a discussion on that and alter our budget to the towns in the sense that we add a line item for overtime potentially maybe 20,000, and we monitor it, which is significantly more reduced than what we have expended. But Zach seems to have come up with a way to fix it, and we can monitor it for the next 3 months of pay, you know, there's 8 more pay periods. But as Board of Oversight, we have the obligation to reach out to the communities, so maybe all of us could help the mentoring group that Zach has set up to get the call staff more involved or encourage them to get more involved so we can cover the shortfall, but also have more involvement for next year so we can have a more positive impact on the budget. And
Zach, you see us running out of money?
I want to make sure we're on the same page here. By my calculations, our salary, we've spent 97% of where we should have at this point this year. We currently budget within our full-time salaries 250 hours of overtime pay per individual per year. That's
about 10%. 2,400 hours a year, about.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
About 10%.
Of overtime. So we have overspent, or I should say, we've spent more in our full-time staff as a result of overtime this far in the year because we haven't had the per diem availability that we would have liked. But as a result, we've underspent on the per diems at about 80% of where we would expect to be at this part of the year. So where we've fallen short on the per diem staff, we've then had to utilize...
Is that a wash?
Well, it comes to 97% of where we would be at this point.
Your actual plan.
So the point is, because we don't have the per diems, we need to keep the ambulance rolling, so we utilize overtime, and we're spending... The salary line item is working out even, otherwise we'd be double counting those additional hours.
But the problem has been within a couple of employees that you've said you've addressed.
Yes.
And we're going to watch it. But yeah, it's important because maybe some of the... On call or what do you call them? They're not really volunteers, but the people that work part time haven't had the opportunity because they're not offered it because the people who do the scheduling work for themselves.
I 100% disagree with that statement.
Right. But then I don't. What was the? I mean, we've asked you probably 4 or 5 months in a row to deal with this overtime thing, and it seems like it hasn't changed. Maybe now it has, but.
We can talk about that. I want to talk about these numbers that Carolyn has for this thing that we're going to overspend the salary stuff. Because it looks, from my calculations, we're right on track, if not a little bit under, for where we should be at this point.
Well, I have the actual payrolls here, week by week payrolls.
Hey, Carolyn, can I just break in for 1 second?
Sure.
Is this getting a bit beyond the conversation we were going to have with Joe?
Yeah.
We should finish up with Joe and then have this conversation.
Yeah, no, but I was...
In due respect to his time.
Yes, and I agree. But one of the things that Joe had recommended in his report is that we pull out overtime.
Yeah, and I said that primarily for tracking. And because if you track it, you put a number on it, then you can monitor it, and it gives you much better... insight into what you need to do to get control of your payroll. The expenditures themselves may not change, but they're just being tracked separately, so with more clarity. And that's most towns do that. Most police departments, fire departments, they have an overtime line item.
Right.
And quite frankly, a lot of those towns, those chiefs like the OT because it gives them greater flexibility as opposed to a full-time staff person with benefits. So it varies.
The only reason I had brought it up is because we as a board, we are generating enough overtime that if in fact the call staff is not going to be productive and pan out as part of the budget, and maybe we should look. We're getting into the $100,000 realm, and that it means that we could hire another staff person rather than paying overtime. So, I mean, that was one of the reasons I wanted to make sure we discussed that.
Zach, how many guys you have right now? You have 8 full time, and you?
Correct.
Or are you 8?
No, I'm the 9th. 8 in the ambulance, full-time and then me administrative during the day.
So that was the other, my third point. We really have 8-9 full-time on shift, not the 8.
I defer to Zach on that.
So those 8 people cover ambulance 1 24/7, and then I'm the ambulance 2 during Monday through Friday. So
we would consider him a full-time employee. Mm-hmm. Which makes, I don't think.
Well,
sort of, right?
It might be 60 hours.
What I was looking at is full-time people with full-time shifts. I mean, Zach is. He is on an ambulance when it's needed, the second ambulance out, not the first ambulance. So that seems separate to me.
It was funny because I did ask somebody, that says, Zach is full time, isn't he? And they said, yeah. And I said, I was talking to Bobby earlier. He says, well, I thought 2 years ago we had authorized the hiring of a 9th person. But I voted no. Zach won't let me forget that. But I could have swore everybody else voted yes, so I thought we had 9 full-time. We have 9 full-time employees.
Not including Zach.
Correct, yes.
Including Zach.
Including, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Yes. Okay, good. All right, so if we go through your thing, we know location. Your next section was location.
We all agree that's our priority.
There's no question about that.
Yeah, and it's not that
you talked about,
self-evident.
You talked about run.
There was a motion.
We're going to discuss that later.
Okay,
I'm not going to forget it.
Okay,
thank you, Zach. Yeah. I'm not going to forget. And Jonathan's right. We need to make a few discussions, but we should go through this first.
And I'd say that the run volume numbers was primarily for your information, probably stuff you've seen already. But usually those kind of questions come up, and comparison to assessment ratios and so forth is an internal discussion.
One of the most amazing numbers, I think, is that when you look at the how we came up with our assessment, to the town, it seems to be spot on.
Yeah,
I mean,
it works.
It's. I mean, I don't know how.
How was that done?
I mean, we sat down and we decided to put that 50%. EQV in there, and I think that EQV really it helped moderate some of the other stuff. So I think it's actually pretty good numbers. Zach, we have talked about scheduling, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that goes sometimes. We're going to go back to that and talk about the overtime also part of the scheduling.
The one question I had before we finish move on to that is. You had said that Town of Deerfield should adopt a write-off policy. We were thinking of the write-off policy as a group. Mm-hmm. So we would think of the write-off policy and then recommend it to Deerfield, and then Deerfield has to be the one that...
it would have to be a Deerfield policy. Because that's where the finances are running through.
Okay.
And you could recommend one, but I would... if Town of Deerfield doesn't like it, they don't have to adopt it. They could do their own. And quite frankly, I don't know a whole lot about write-off policies. I did a little bit of research, pulled up a couple of things, and it strikes me that there's two parts of it. One is the determination that a bill is uncollectible, not unlike making the determination that a property tax bill is uncollectible. Same sort of exercise. And then there's the flip side of it is, making something, writing something off does not relieve the debtor from the obligation. A waiver would. If you wanted to have a provision that allowed to waive those fees, then you could do that. Not all towns do that, but some have.
I think that's what Whately previously did.
We
got an ambulance. We just waived it. We just said, we're not getting it. You know what? Let's move on.
I'm sure Deerfield had the same thing, because we had it. Every once in a while, the EMS director would bring us a list, no names. It would just be, he assigned a number to him, 832.
Right.
And he said, look, we're not getting it. And he'd make a recommendation to waive it.
Or insurance is not going to pay this. And
yeah.
Right.
We always did that.
We always did that. And it would burn me up, but it's the way it goes.
Yeah.
Well, there's very, I chaired a committee a few years ago at DLS that looked at ways to help collectors collect money that was out there. And the ambulance stuff was among the hardest because there's no legal statutory mechanism.
Insurance doesn't pay whatever it wants to pay.
You can't hold somebody's license or anything. You can only, civil remedies are the only things you have. And, you know, do you really want to be attacked for taking a guy to a small claims court, you know, when he's got a busted leg? And it's just politically not very
good. Well, you see, I thought it was the insurance that was my beef. That, you know, we don't pay, we're not going to pay this. We're going to only pay 75%.
You're not going to win, though.
No, and that's what burned me. I just, so much for insurance.
The administration, that was pretty straightforward.
Where are you, Tom?
Administration, section 8.
And I think that section, section 8 administration.
Oh, maybe.
Section 8. Oh, yeah, way back. We're on page 19. Are you talking governance?
I'm on page 9.
9.
You're right, page 9.
Yeah, I'm trying to get right off.
No, you jumped ahead, Carolyn.
We all did, Tom. Yeah.
I'm sorry.
So, on that, I didn't have a problem with that. Although putting Zach's or the director's job description in the IMA is something that I had never thought about. We had never even discussed. So,
Just information. You know, it just helps clarify.
But a job description can change. It's a dynamic piece of paper.
It is, but it's a contract. I assume that the job description is part of his contract. Do you have a contract?
I do not.
No. Okay.
The town of Deerfield Personnel Board approves.
Yeah. Job descriptions can change, and if they change significantly, you have to change your personnel, you know, classifications and so forth. But they can.
Okay. So we can discuss that billing, the write-off policy. We just discussed that. The operating budget we talked about. The overtime line item we discussed with Joe. I was very impressed, Joe, with your town meeting warrant format. Mm-hmm. I think it's much better than how you provide the accounts right now. I think it's much better. It's when someone looks at it, you can really know exactly how it's operating instead of just putting a number.
Let me ask you this, though, because Whately doesn't do line item by line item on any department. Mm-hmm. And so we would be, and maybe that's just the reality of being part of a regional thing, we would be treating this differently than anything else we budget.
This is just a suggestion. I had somebody else, when I was talking to somebody about it, and they said, I don't know if we want to do that. That might be more information than we really want to put out there. And you don't even know if people care about it.
Well, right, and more hours for debate.
And there's no legal obligation to do this. So I just threw it out there.
Yeah, I get it.
I think it's important. I would think our finance committee should see it in that format.
Mm-hmm. What the finance committee
is. Oh, I agree with that. I'm just saying it's coming before right now.
Oh, I agree. Yeah. Yeah. You're right, Jonathan. But I think at the minimum, the finance committee may want to look at it that format. I think that's a nice format for.
I agree with that.
For the finance committee.
And that's always the case. Finance committees get more detail than you're going to present to town meeting.
So maybe that's something we can work on next year, Jack.
And the other thing I would say about that, and this to Zach, is that you really should work with Brenda about line items in your account, like where you want to spend money. There's no right or wrong. It's what works best for you in terms of identifying. Because when there's a line item that you want, it goes into the chart of accounts, and when you get your expenditure report, it's going to show the appropriation and what's been spent, what's left over in that line item. If it's something rather than being grouped with something else.
Yep.
So it's not going to go to town meeting, but it's going to help you. So I'll work with Brenda on that. I don't know what your arrangement is going to be when you have your new facility, but town departments do not rent from other town departments. Money just doesn't work that way. So think about a pilot if there's some money going back to the town of Deerfield.
But my only concern there is that we've been repeatedly told the word tenant. And if you're a tenant, you pay rent. If you're not a tenant, you pay a pilot.
Well, No, it's like a water department. That's the thing, that we go back to, you're a town, the SCEMS is a town department. And so it's not a tenant, it's occupying a town building.
Right, but my point is, well, we don't want to get too in the wheels here. But we've been told repeatedly about this, that SCEMS, by the town of Deerfield, the SCEMS is nothing more than a tenant, and that's the way it goes.
I guess I would say,
I'm with you on this. I'm just pointing out that we need to change the language.
You're right. We can bat that around, I suppose. But I view it like a water department that's an enterprise fund. They pay pilots. They don't pay rent for the space they occupy in a town building.
I had never heard that. That's you can be in this business a long time and you learn something every day.
Okay. It's what towns try and get out of nonprofits, schools, right, churches, and some.
Waitley did the first pilot for solar in the state.
They're negotiated amounts, and they're usually far less than what the tax burden might be. Indirect costs. I think it's important to separate out indirect costs. It just as an expense category, it's not a direct cost. It's an indirect cost, and it's something that the enterprise has to pay back to Deerfield, and you don't have to itemize it in the budget format, but it should be identified separately. Even if you list the expenses with all other expenses, have some sort of indicator, whether it's an asterisk or in parentheses, this is an indirect cost. It's an expense of the enterprise, but it's an indirect one. I wasn't sure whether legal expenses were intended to be an indirect cost or a direct cost, so just that, look at it, or both. They could be both, but you might want to look at that. And we talked about retained earnings. The only thing I'd say about capital is, in all the conversations about the assessments and the capital and the retained earnings, I think it's really important to take your capital, and as Zach has done, plot it out for 10 years. It's pretty definable. And look at your retained earnings and how those retained earnings can cover those expenses. So you can say to your people going forward, we've got our capital covered. And you can see what's left out of retained earnings. And if it gets too low, you can account for that and act. And it just gives you a clearer picture if you plot it out and just project. And projecting revenues and expenditures is also a good part of that. It's a financial plan looking forward. And this is not complicated in the sense there's not a whole lot of moving parts to this compared to other kind of towns and so forth. So it's something that can be done, and it's judgment calls. When you get out 3, 4, 5 years, what's the certainty things are going to play out the way you've anticipated, but you make adjustments and it gives you a good sense of where you can be and where you have to be with money. The intermunicipal agreement section is really food for thought, for you folks. I'm a lawyer, so I have fun reading these things. And I have written these, and I've read a ton of them when I was at DLS, and just clarification. And I think a lot of it is merely just words, like word choices. I think it's difficult and potentially confusing when the Board of Oversight has supervision over the ambulance director, and the Town of Deerfield Town Administrator has supervision. One has overall supervision, the other one has day-to-day. Well, where's the line?
And I think the way this was created, at least this is what I voted on, was that whoever the fiscal agent was, in this case Deerfield, would simply, unless it's personnel matters, I get that, whatever the insurance rates are and that kind of stuff, whatever was recommended by the Board of Oversight would be implemented and administered by the town administrator, but that's as far as the oversight went. That it goes to some comments later on. I'd be hard-pressed to believe this board would be thrilled if we made a recommendation about hiring, about anything that was overturned by the town of Deerfield. So I think, at least from Whately's perspective, we were signing on to something where this board is the supervisor and the town administrator of the town of Deerfield is our agent to that supervision.
Well, the statute says that the employees are employees of the town of Deerfield.
I get that part.
It's hard to reconcile those two things.
I get that part, but I think, you know, this board works pretty well, but I think that the IMA should be actually tightened so that we protect ourselves from people who aren't as responsible as we are down the road, so that one town, whoever the fiscal agent is, can't run off and say, we're the boss.
Well, you've lived with this now for a couple of years, and my sense is that you do, there are aspects of it that you maybe haven't gone back to the IMA to look at how actual practice plays against what the words are, but that's probably a good exercise to go through and to think about the changes that you want to make just for those kind of reasons. You know, as I said, these are just my observations going through and differing opinions can certainly be had on the issues.
Well, it's hard because I think when we first started, we wanted whoever the director was of the service, we wanted them to have someone to be able to go to for help, you know, with the budgeting process, with the, you know, if there's questions to be asked, and I would have to go back to the town of Deerfield, and see if they give their town administrator the authority to be in charge of it. I don't know how you guys work, because I think that goes through their board of selectmen, right? It doesn't really go, the town administrator doesn't, and I don't think by statute the town administrator has that authority most of the time. Or I think the town administrator has the authority, whatever authority the selectmen give the town.
We say he speaks on our behalf.
Yeah. So I think the town administrator, we'd always thought was that source for the director, whomever that director was, to go to and get help.
And that's how it works.
We
went months without even a town administrator.
And Zach didn't even notice.
So, I mean, but Wendy is there, you know, now that we have Wendy on board, Wendy is there if Zach has a personnel issue or, you know.
But we need somebody like that because we don't have, unfortunately, we don't have HR departments, you know.
Yeah.
We don't have an HR, and that's a huge concern.
And that's why Wendy is a good resource.
No, I wasn't arguing one case or the other. I was arguing more in clarifying languages so that you all understand, you know, what your role is and what his role is and so forth. And if you think things are fine the way they are, then that's...
Well, we should. I think we should review the IMA because that's...
Well, we should all.
We should, yeah.
I mean, we should be doing it every year.
Because it's dynamic, it's not static.
Yeah.
Well, like you said, it's always changing.
All right.
All right.
Anything else?
Why are you recommending Article 2, Section 2, Clause A? Under Clause A, the ambulance director is appointed by the tenant, taken into consideration. If the clause speaks to the initial ambulance director, just by point of clarification, I think it speaks to all ambulance directors.
Well, that's, again, when I read these things and I, what is my impression? And that might have been the intent, and if that was the intent, it should be stated more clearly.
Okay,
that's all. That's all.
And I like the for any reason, actually, too.
Yeah. But it should be clear if the town of Deerfield is obligated to act on the recommendation of the board, it should say that. If the town of Deerfield can just merely take the recommendation of the board and take other recommendations from the finance committee or the then it should say that. You know, there should be a process by which a candidate gets there.
I agree. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Yeah. And I thought that, you know, I don't know what the prospects are to get another town in, but you know, that it was unclear to me whether that the last thing or whether when a town opts in, what happens to your assessment.
Right. Mm-hmm.
That's unsafe.
Good point.
I think this is great stuff, like noodle.
Well.
So you're working full-time in the car now, Joe?
I don't work full-time. I work on a project basis. I'm essentially special projects. I worked a lot on the broadband stuff when that was around with MDI. And I've done seminars, a lot of seminars for the COG over the years. And now I'm doing community compact cabinet projects. And quite frankly, as long as I work on grant money. So as long as the money comes in, I'll be around. That's our deal.
How does everybody on the board feel about understanding of enterprise funds? Do everybody have a warm, fuzzy feeling that they understand how they work?
Not really.
We have learned. Do you guys don't have them in town?
We do, but I think there's been a lot of, well, there's two things I was gonna ask. One is trying to maybe work with Zach, maybe with a budget and coming up with, and I think Zach, you said, and I personally think that's one thing where we've fallen down as a board. We haven't necessarily given the Zach training that he needs in certain aspects. But like on the budgets, maybe if he sat down with us and listened to us, what we have concerns with how the budget process goes after going through a couple, and maybe taking that information and then working with Zach and the town of Deerfield's financial people to put together a structure that may be able to help how we do our budgeting process.
And I would say that you take the expenditures today, since your operation, and you put them on a spreadsheet so you've got a historical perspective, and then look at, okay, what are the next 3 years going to look like?
Yeah.
And including capital, including retained earnings, including cash flow, including expenditures, and get a sense of, when I was talking about weaning yourself off the retained earnings, that's the way you do it. You look at what your expenditures are going out, what our need is going to be, what can we do with those retained earnings, how much can we reasonably give back for assessments. Maybe we give back 10% this year and 8% next year and 6%, or maybe it goes in the other direction. But it's important to have that kind of context, and what would happen. Do you do what-if scenarios? How would this work if we were to put a reserve for unforeseen and extraordinary expenses? How much should that be? You know, and so you look at the playout. What's the largest expense we could have that goes overboard? And it's the on-call stuff probably, or the overtime. Well, what's the worst case scenario with that? And maybe you plan for that rather than being conservative. You put a big number in there, and then after a few years, you decide that big number isn't necessary. That we've got control of everything, and now we know we can live with a smaller. So it really, doing tracking just is very informative. Very informative.
This might sound a little bougie to you, but you know, what you just said about tracking, I get that. But it seems like everything you were saying is talking about the future, you know, and estimating stuff. And that's kind of what our state government does and gets in big trouble all the time. They make these projections. Wouldn't it be more prudent to look at the history and where you've been and what happens leading up to it? It's one thing to take a pie in the sky guess of where you're going, but your history is going to give you the track record of where.
Well, that's what I was saying. That's why you take the last 3 years of experience and you plot it out, and then you just continue those lines across, and you could say we're going to increase everything by 2%, or we're going to increase this by $20,000 and this one by $5,000. You could, there are formats to do that sort of thing, and I mean, I've done those. And yeah, you do exactly that. You look at the thing about your history, though, it's a little bit up and down right now. Mm-hmm. And it hasn't leveled out yet, and you're still on a curve here. So that's why you're conservative going forward, because you don't know exactly. You haven't really fallen into any good solid trends.
Well, you can't expect to in 3 years, or in less than 3 years.
Well, no, and especially, I mean, your reimbursement costs are up and down, and I mean, again, your potential. We don't know what's going to happen.
Well, you're going to have building expenses.
Yep.
And building expenses are always more than people anticipate. And you're going to have, what was the other thing I was thinking about? the billing expenses, and yeah, just about. But so it's yeah, you're gonna have to wait a few years. You're gonna have to get into that new facility and see what those operating costs are gonna be. That's gonna be a big number. I think it's gonna be bigger than you think. And so always is. So, okay.
Thank you so much.
No.
Well, I am an employee of the COG, therefore I'm essentially available. And I'm always on. I was talking to Sherry. Is Sherry gone? She's gone. Sherry and I have conversations. Marilyn Wilson and I have conversations. Kevin Fox and I have conversations. So I view myself something of a help desk. And so, you know, people shouldn't be reluctant to give me a call and say, can you give me, you know, your thoughts on this? If you think my thoughts are worthwhile.
Yeah.
And so I'm always happy to do that.
Great.
Well, and thanks should go to Tom and the town of Sunderland for moving this forward.
Yeah.
Because they did it on their own.
Just a step one. Because I still think that, you know, once we're settled into our new home, we have to get, then we have to start the next step, which is running it like a business. And again, it's been hard. It's because we have all these other, there's all these other things going around. And I think that's really the work of the board at that point is running it like a business. And that's what Joe's at. I think that's what I took out of Joe's thing.
My last comment would be Skroskis. John, do you know the Skroskis?
Quite well.
And Ronnie Pachowski's, the Pachowski's in Deerfield. I went to college with both of them.
With Don?
And Frank.
All right, Ben.
You just think you went to college?
Don't dare come back here. No.
Yeah, I usually see him once a year when we all get together. But thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Joe. Okay, so we have a motion on the table.
And the person who made the motion has to leave. So, what was the motion? 10%.
Yeah.
I second it.
Yeah, I mean, I honestly, you guys, I think it's a minimum of what we can do, and we can always revisit and bump it up down the road. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. It's a good start.
So, conversation?
I think it's warranted.
Kip?
I think it's a good idea. I don't know if it's quite enough. I really see there's a lot of money there. You know, in our costs are pretty much, we know what the labor is going to be, and we know what the cost of the ambulance is. And next year, we're not going to buy an ambulance, so that's going to be even more. And I filed it.
We'll buy furniture.
Yeah, but we're not going to spend $500,000 on it.
Well,
but you don't know what kind of chair I sit in.
I'm
going
to roll one of those over the town hall.
You know, I see, and it isn't like we're saving $500,000 every year. I understand that. But, you know, this the 10% basically represents what we spent in overtime this year. And as long as we can keep a good handle on that, you know, that money is going to primarily just be sitting there.
And that's my concern, that we don't necessarily have that. We don't know that we have that ability. That's my only concern. But I would.
But after three quarters of the year, we haven't touched any of it. We've actually increased it by.
But isn't that because we haven't touched that line item, but we've paid for it out of another line item. Mm-hmm. So we have to.
No, but if you think, the assessments.
The assessments right now for
the assessments have stayed the same, and you know we've already taken the money out for the ambulance, and we've got $700,000 or just shy of $700,000 without 2 months of income in this figure, and without the fourth quarter contributions from the towns. So that's going to bump that up a total of probably another $175,000 to $200,000.
That's so, less payroll and everything else we're going to spend.
So, no, that's just if you added that now. But and I know that we got ongoing payroll.
Do you think we could do the 10% and then revisit the discussion of forgoing an assessment in a quarter next year?
I
you know what I mean? Like when we get into like you know, September, or I mean, after the first of the year, kind of see where we are, you know, for giving a quarter up here and there to kind of start bringing that.
I guess Kip would argue, and you would argue that doesn't help with our current budget projections, and we all are trying to put together our budgets right now. But
kind of, yeah. I mean,
Yeah, I mean, if we do the 10% now, we're good with that, and then we see, because you're still feeling we're leaving that in there, and if we come back in a few months, half a year goes by, we still see, you know, 600,000 in there, we could do that one option we had of foregoing an assessment to the town on a quarter.
Well, 10% is about 150,000.
Right. How about we take a happy medium, because we were talking about not paying an assessment, which is about 25%, mm-hmm. and then we're talking about 10%. How about maybe we go to 15?
I was going to say, I would entertain that, as long as everyone understands that we need, right, as a board.
You're taking your first motion off the table?
Okay, yes.
You're removing it. Okay.
And Trevor's going to second my removal.
A second your removal.
So are you putting another motion up there?
I will motion. I'll make a motion for 15% with the caveat that we as a group, or whatever this group consists of down the road, if we need to increase that, we need to say, no, you know what, I'm not going to be labeled with raising taxes by 15%.
Right.
This is about being smart now with today's budget, but not at the expense of being smart if we have to increase it down the road.
Well, I think that's where you bring the historical information in, Jonathan, where you say, like for the town of Deerfield, this is our current assessment, at which we are talking about reducing by 15%, is more... I mean, it's far less than what we were paying for a basic surface that was not 24/7.
And not as good, right. Right. I just want to make sure that we
people need
really
to understand
that.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
That's where the historical has to be.
All right. I'll make a motion for 15%.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion made and second. I'm just going to do some clerical, okay? So we still have to make our numbers balance. So if we reduce the assessment by 15%, we still need to take retained earnings and apply it to the budget.
Right. So Kip would argue of the 7 and change, it would go down to 5 and change.
And what I would like to do is while we're working, the bottom line, we can do that vote, but I would like to still fiddle around with the budget for the next couple of meetings, because I think it's important to talk about, you know, breaking out the overtime. Should we hire another person? What, you know, different things in this line item.
As long as the number doesn't change.
Right. What we're voting today is the bottom line.
Yeah.
Or what you all are voting is the bottom line reduction. But within the budget, we're still going to take some of Joe's recommendations and make it.
I just want to make sure that I'm not doubting Kip's numbers on the 700, the 500. I just want to make sure that we're taking into account, out of that, we're paying for the capital in this budget. There's $100,000 for operating reserves. There's $51,000 for the... That those numbers are being accounted for. I don't want to come up short on things.
Like,
as long as the...
When I spoke with Brenda today, there's $345,000 in that reserve account today.
And that's having paid for the
We've only paid for the chassis portion of the truck, and she didn't have the figure on that. But that $285,000 is part of that $345,000. So once that ambulance is paid for, is at the end of this April, Seth?
Mm-hmm. Or it's coming in March, I think.
Right. Well, once the ambulance is paid for,
right,
there should be $60,000 in the reserve fund.
The reserve fund.
Mm-hmm. Which... I don't understand that, but that's what she said. Because I asked her directly.
What's the difference between, well,
I don't know. I asked her if that money had come out of the enterprise fund. She said it was already set aside.
But this is that's a total, right? Is that balance for where we have 345? Is that the amount she was talking about? That's our ending balance.
Yep, 300.
That's our ending balance.
345,000.
After you guys crunch numbers, I'm fine with whichever direction you guys go. 10 or 15.
Are you voting for 15?
I'm saying whatever you guys ultimately decide. Is that allowed?
Well, no. We can vote on reducing the assessment by 15%.
Yeah.
Then we still have to figure out how to make all that happen.
Yeah, we can do that.
Let's take a vote. So we can leave.
Correct. Yeah.
So all those in favor of reducing assessment by 15%, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
So we have a 5-0 vote. Zach, could you record that, please? Okay.
Thank you, John.
Thanks.
Now we have to be able to put the right numbers in to make the budget balance.
Just if the number that yeah. Zach gave me was 1,153,621 even. So if you take 15% of that.
No, 15% of the assessment. The community assessment is $607,216.
Like the Deerfield assessment is $387,000.
What was the total, Tom? You got that?
Yeah, it's 607,216. That's a total assessment.
That's a total assessment.
Of member towns, yeah. Is that what you got, Zach?
So 15%, that's only $91,000.
I think you're looking at FY17, I believe. FY18 assessment to member towns I have is 583,152. Oh, hold on. Sorry. Oh my God.
No, I think I'm looking at 18, Zach.
My apologies. Those are different numbers. You are absolutely 100% right. 607,216.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's what I have for assessment.
Yep. Correct.
And then we offset the total budget 1,153,621 with $546,000. It was like 450,000
of revenue from services. Yep.
450,000. That was revenue coming in.
Yeah, projected revenue for next year.
So 650.
Should be 96. Well, yeah. It's on the under revenue sources on your budget.
Yeah, the other revenue sources is 546,405. Zach, is that correct? 546,405.
Yes. So that's.
I'm just it's the budget assistance to town. How many books are?
Minus the 450. So we were already putting in $96,905 from retained earnings.
Correct.
Already.
Yep, and that's covering the capital costs plus an additional, I think, 4,000 to balance the budget.
Correct. So total would be 607, 15 to be 60, that's 91,000, right? So there'd be another $91,000. So that would be what we'd have to take out of retained earnings.
Right. So if I'm understanding right, you take the assessment and we're going to reduce it by 15%.
Correct.
So we have to take $91,082.40 out of retained earnings.
Correct.
That was great.
So what would that leave us in retained earnings?
Well, it depends if you add in the reserve account, which I still don't really understand.
I think the reserve account, there isn't a reserve account. It's
yes,
just the
correct.
Balance in the bottom of the line here is what we have. This is the balance after everything's been, you know, we have revenue coming in, we have all the expenses going out. We have $345 right now. As of, you know, this is as of, I guess, the end of February.
The end of February. No, the end of January. It's posted as of 131. The one I have.
Is that? I have the
422.
So you're saying that you don't know of a separate reserve account other than the enterprise fund?
The revenues.
I see.
The revenues have only been posted through 131.
So we have more revenue.
We have more money.
Okay.
That's how come KIPP has a higher number.
I see.
Because they're not official.
I see.
Yet. And I mean that's the billing.
So we're still covered. We have still.
Right. And no one and all three towns have not paid their fourth quarter.
Fourth quarter, and that's still coming in.
Which is 25% of the budget.
I'm gonna have to talk with Brenda tomorrow, because I don't, the way she explained it to me, there was two different funds, the enterprise fund, which is the overall one, and then the reserve fund that was earmarked for the ambulance and stuff. I don't understand that.
Is that the previous Deerfield EMS ambulance fund? Because there was still revenues coming in for transports that Deerfield EMS conducted that I think were being placed in a different account?
I thought it was money that was rolled over.
Either way, I don't know of anything that isn't on the.
I'll find out tomorrow.
So basically, we reduced additional $91,082.
Yep.
So we had to put that into that revenue from retained. So we have to, we're gonna get total of $187,487.
And 85 cents?
Yeah, something like that.
Yeah, okay, yep.
Now, Kip, in reference to something you were saying before, do we hold off, do we tell the accountants or treasurers in the towns that we're gonna hold off billing them for right now?
No.
No.
We have to, for the.
Yeah, we're not.
We'll look at that in 6 months or whatever.
No, that was.
It was an either or kind of thing?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, to me, that's not conservative.
We could do.
Right.
I would rather have our savings projected from a year ahead rather than shortchange.
We don't know what the year's gonna be.
For, because there's still the remaining part of the year.
And again, I think this is the right track. I really believe that, and that's what we've been talking about. As soon as we can figure out how much revenue we're taking in, we can get that next year, take that right out of the retained earnings. So we're not, we don't want to hold on to that. There's no reason to hold on to it. But we also don't want a budget too close where we could get ourselves in trouble either.
Right.
Right, that's why I want us to pay the assessment.
Right.
Which we've already, all of us have budgeted.
All right, so we're fine with that right now.
Yeah.
Good.
Okay, agenda. Director's report.
Moving right along, director's report. So, so I wanted to discuss real quick, just touch on the tornado that struck Conway. It sounds like there's either some misunderstandings or some half-truths that have been circulating at least around the town of Deerfield about our involvement or lack thereof. So I summarized everything that happened. So the tornado struck Conway at the end of last month. It caused a significant amount of damage. That was a Saturday night. And it was a long duration event, so they called in the incident command team, mutual aid from outside areas, and the purpose is that any sort of large scale event, you can't handle it yourself. But kind of disaster response 101 is that you want to call in resources outside of your close area. You always want to leave resources to handle all of your baseline calls on top of that. In Massachusetts, we have an ambulance task force. We have incident command task forces that pull those resources from further away. It takes time for those resources to show up. So in that interim, in that time that it took those resources to come from further away, South County EMS reached out to Conway EMS and the incident command post and said, you know, we will offer you whatever resources we can spare to help you. That's what we're here for. This is something that we've done for Conway in the past, even when the truck goes out of service for maintenance or something like that. And that included all the way up to covering their 911 calls for whatever duration they needed. So that allows their staff to recuperate, to rest, to be able to turn their pagers off and not have to worry about their citizens not getting care, that they could focus on themselves. And we ended up, we offered that for however long they needed. They ended up not having to call us for any 911 calls. We had, during that operational period, we actually handled four calls still in our own area. So it didn't affect at all our ability to cover Deerfield, Sunderland, Waitley. And eventually those resources from further away were able to show up in Conway and take care of the the way it needs to be taken care of. So, you know, I think it kind of, as textbook as a tornado can be in Western Massachusetts, the system came together, offered the services that we could, and we called for resources outside of our area, not to tax anybody. Kind of on the flip side of that, the tragic house fire in Warwick, we were on the opposite side of that. So South County EMS actually got called in to Warwick to help with them because their local resources were totally taxed. And because we are the outside resource, we were able to tone out and get our local responders to cover the ambulance here. We were able to absorb that in our community because we didn't have the emergency, and then we were able to provide those services to the town of Warwick for a short period of time, shorter than the tornado, but we were able to do that. So,
I think, Zach, where the confusion came is that people don't understand how the backup in the ambulances work, and it was the response. You know, I authorized the police and the highway immediately because Trevor was texting, you know, pictures because his parents lived there, so in the affected area. So it was easy for our departments to respond, and you see it, but it doesn't work that way. I mean, because the town is Deerfield wasn't involved, but it's different with the ambulance backup, and it's more like a mutual aid and call down that exists with the fire departments, and I don't think people got that, and so I think there was a misunderstanding.
Yeah.
And so along those lines, because I know Tom is on the exact same page as I am, and I don't, and Jonathan. You know, we've worked together for years. It doesn't matter if it's our neighbors, we're going.
Right.
And we're authorizing. So I don't think it ever crossed any of our minds that we weren't participating, but I think it was the call down of how the response was that was the issue. And so along those lines, like I said, there is this huge drill happening in October, the 19th through the 22nd, and it's 1938, hurricane scenario, and it will start like on a Tuesday, and so there'll be boots on the ground I think Thursday, but then the Harriman Dam is supposed to let go like on a Friday and
simulated.
Yeah,
of course,
yeah.
All this simulated.
Of course. So anyway, they had a meeting, just had the first meeting, and they had Canadian Air Force. I mean, all these different agencies. This giant one. It's the one that comes around, that FEMA exercise that comes around by region every decade or so. And it just happens that they're going to do us. So I was hoping, and when we get to this, our budgets, because we are going to be monitoring the overtime is going to be pulled out, and we are going to be monitoring that. I was hoping that we would appropriate some amount to participate in the drill, because they are going to do a transport, and they want an ambulance already. They want local ambulances to transport, and I had already volunteered us as one of the ones that, because it's a combination, you know, of very small ambulances up, you know, further up on the Deerfield watershed. So we would be the main organized ambulance. So I had hoped that this oversight board would be supportive of, you know, a small amount of overtime so that we could participate, because it would be actual transports and it would be a decontamination part drill too, because the letting go of the Harriman Dam is going to involve the Yankee Row, you know, their caskets or whatever are going to be washed out, because it's the way they are secured or something, there was that potential. So there was going to be some kind of radioactive kind of stuff. So it was important to practice that decon stuff. And I thought, we don't have very much opportunity to do that. So that was a good thing too. So
yeah.
Whatever. It was just along the lines.
My only thing I would say is that is, I would hope you know that whoever on the board, one thing Deerfield's on the way, the economy can argue about school budgets and all kinds of different things, But whenever there's been any type of concern, none of us, when Sunderland had problems, the first thing Deerfield calls up and say, do you guys need help? When Deerfield has a problem, we call up and say, do you guys, and our equipment goes over the bridge and your equipment comes over the bridge from Deerfield without question. What happened a few years ago, had a problem with their dike, we called their selectmen and we said, look, if you need our payload or dump trucks, whatever you need, you have them. So I would hope, the only thing that disturbed me when I heard about it was that someone said we didn't go because we didn't have the money in the budget.
That, those words, I just
hope you realize that I don't think anybody on this Board of Oversight and the finance committees in the towns would ever give you a hard time about responding to one of our neighbors in need.
Of course.
That's the only thing I need to say.
And just to calm any fears that anybody might have had, we offered all the resources we could, and there wasn't that, just like you said, South County EMS operates under the same concern for all of our neighbors, and it wasn't, that issue wasn't something that played a factor in that.
We're too small. We've learned over the years, and you've been a police officer in town, and you understand. We all know that if something major happens, we're on our own for 3 to 5 days.
Yeah.
So we have to count on one another. Mm-hmm. That was my only thing.
Absolutely.
And we've never told you that. I didn't think we needed to, but just so anybody knows, we never say no.
But what was awkward is that, we have the oversight board instead of one person that's responsible for saying you are authorized. I think there was a gap there, and I just wanted to be clear in the minutes that you know that I just can't imagine if you want us to make a vote or something to make it clear, but you have the authority to spend any.
There was nothing that didn't happen that day because somebody or myself thought we weren't authorized or we didn't have the money. I want to make that clear. We did everything that we would have if we had bottomless pockets and all those things. So I want to be clear on that. If anybody thinks that we refuse to help, that's not the case. So,
but you do have, just so people understand, there is protocol, and it's good that you laid this out, that you have to go further out away so that you don't sacrifice if there was another mass casualty in the location that you were equipped to handle that.
Yeah, I mean, I'm a paramedic instructor, and this is what we teach. It's called moving the emergency.
Right.
So, if you deplete all your resources to help this crashed school bus, now when somebody calls 911 because they're having a heart attack, you don't have anybody left.
Right.
And that's disaster response 101. So you make sure that you can cover.
And so you have the protocols, and everybody is aware of that.
Yes.
So that's why you go outside the region.
Yep.
Gotcha. That helps.
Mentor EMT engagement.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. So, a catch up on kind of our progress with our staff. Three new local EMTs moved to the area recently in the past few months.
Right.
And they've been brought on board and are trained and are taking shifts, so that's nice. Great. That's a significant commitment on our part, which we're happy to participate in because of what it means for our community and for our department. But it goes back onto those mentors that I was talking about previously, and they really donate their time and their expertise to make that happen. As far as the continued outreach, I mentioned this last year in July when we got recertified that OEMS needs us to prove that we're doing our orientation packets. And it was our goal for the first half of this past year, or so, last half of last year, to get that totally completed. So as of today, of our 41 people on our staff, the vast majority have completed or are about to complete this orientation packet. So we've met that goal thereabouts. It was January 1st is what we set for ourselves, and there's just a couple trickles left. And there's only a handful of people left that haven't even started that packet. And of those six people, four of them are paramedics with full-time jobs and live outside of our coverage area and haven't been picking up shifts. So they're just kind of drifting away. And then two of those people are local EMTs. And we're talking about engagement and trying to keep our local EMTs involved. So of the 41 people in the department, the two local EMTs who haven't completed the packet when it's stated that they're not going to renew their EMT coming up. And the other one, we're still trying to engage, but isn't replying with us. I reached out again today just to touch base. I actually did see that individual on a call. He was an incredible help. He responded with another agency. So just touching base and seeing, you know, what his intention is and making sure. Part of this orientation packet, it can be a little overwhelming, especially if you feel like you've been an EMT for a long time and now this department has grown. We're a full-time paramedic service now. And so the mentors, their job, they've really taken this on, is that it's non-judgmental. You come in, we've got a mentor on every shift now. So whatever schedule that, you know, our local staff or EMTs have, we can accommodate them. They come in, we reimburse them for their time, and we make it a very welcoming, you know, where do you need to talk? You know, how do you feel comfortable about this? And making sure we hit all the marks and we have some finish up for that. So I know I am, but I know that the mentor staff is very proud of that orientation program. It's kind of a model now for other services in the county, and we think it's working pretty well. Still on track for this ambulance delivery end of this month. It's going to paint. Final inspection is tomorrow. So end of March. Knowing these things are probably the beginning of April. But either way, we should see it pretty soon. Facility, nothing to report. I know, I understand that Deerfield Academy is doing their thing with their people. But, you know, I can't speak to their process at all. And I did mention in here that I took the template warrant article that Joe provided, but unfortunately I just ran out of time today. So that's on my docket coming up. But as you said, it would be a good way to present our budget information to the finance committees in the very least. So my intent was to put things in a format that he suggested that might be a little bit easier.
You know, one thing, Zach, and I think it'd be interesting to find out where our retained earnings are coming from.
Yeah.
I think it's increased revenue. We have more rent than we estimated.
It could be, but the numbers Kip said were. How do you say this about? We're disturbing that the amount. Right, but I'd like to know where that.
Where we're missing that.
Right, because when I look at the budget, I mean, most of our budget, the highest aspect of our budget is the highest biggest piece is labor.
Right.
And we're still generating, and so I guess we are getting excess, you know, we're getting revenue, but it would be nice to go through everything else at some point also.
I have a quick question, it's kind of related, but Zach, what is the actual cost of the benefits to the employees, and particularly where I'm going with this was the increase in the health care. If the budget's staying the same, I know that the health insurance increase was 10%.
Yep.
So I'm thinking just that cost to the EMS service is going to be close to $30,000.
So I
right here.
$35,000. So it's in that budget, and
you took it. You took that into consideration. That
absolutely, yeah. And I sat down with Brenda and Barbara and Guy, and I actually have some fresher numbers than what are on that to kind of drill it down.
Yeah, those were a while ago.
Were they, Zach? Do you feel that they're better? I mean, what were the numbers that you have?
I just want to make sure I'm looking at it, because I made this mistake once tonight. They're all better.
Okay.
They're all better, so.
All right. Well, what we can do is fiddle around with the budget. As long, you know, because the bottom line, we voted the bottom line, and that will go forward for our town meetings, because everybody's warrant is going to be closing by the end of the month.
Yeah, it actually, the most updated numbers I had showed a larger decrease. So it's going to, which one do you want? This one? These are the most recent ones there. It's a moving target right now, but I think this is...
Well, it will be a moving target because if they join or fall off, that's what happens.
Oh, yeah, no, I just meant as far as nailing these numbers down for next fiscal year.
Okay.
Okay. All right, so tomorrow or in the very near future, you'll let the town administrators know what the new numbers are?
Yeah, of course.
Assessment values? And because we do have to also, you know, that retainer, it's got to come out of the budget as, have to be part of the budget as well, so.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely.
But maybe we could, maybe after the close of the fiscal year, maybe we should really bring someone in, like almost like a forensic guy, go over the budget top to bottom and find where the retainer is or coming up.
Well, I think that would bring them to come in.
Yeah, I don't think that would be that complicated to go by the line items, and you can see what was budgeted and what was spent.
You would think.
I agree, but I just don't see how we keep.
I've got a breakdown of where that retained earnings, at least my $517,000 from the previous year, so not factoring what we got now, but I have a breakdown of where those numbers come from, and the largest one there is unspent personnel costs, and that's because this is coming from a year before we had that impact shift.
Yes.
So, and that's why we're spending more on target, because we're actually putting bodies in the station now where we weren't before, but a large portion of that, and another one was just more revenue than we were anticipating. That number climbed and we weren't, we hadn't expected that. So those are the biggest, but I got, you know, the other breakdowns. Part of it is that $100,000 that, like he said, you know, was earmarked, but we don't actually have a line item or an account for it, and so that needs to be corrected and pulled back out. So.
Right, so it's not as much.
Yeah.
Okay.
Good. Anything else?
That's it for me.
You want to make a motion?
The motion to adjourn, and then, unless somebody else has anything to talk about. Did you want to tackle the overtime thing later, or do you want to?
We'll get a new payroll, this week, and it's the same projection I had said before. You know, it's just a few percent. It's about $20,000 at the current rate. But Zach has implemented the software package, the mentoring program. I still feel like if we could make a few phone calls to have more call staff instead of overtime, that would be very helpful.
But I did speak to Zach before the meeting. I asked him to bring a copy of the schedule. And it, you know, at least for the next 30 days there is none, so that's good. That's great.
Yeah, I mean, our policy and our practice is that it only goes to overtime if there are per diems available, period. And we only go to overtime within, 12, 24 hours of a shift still remaining open, and only for our primary ambulance. So this is to keep one ambulance, our first ambulance, available to do calls. Right, as of now, next month, I have no overtime schedule, and that's with some people taking vacation time. But what's going to happen is, this week, everybody's got the flu. So I covered 8 hours on Wednesday night because there weren't any per diems available on the team. So there are those last minute call outs, we put it out. Our staff, we have our local EMTs, they have full-time jobs. Our per diems, they all have careers elsewhere, and sometimes they're just not available. And that is the only time that we go to overtime.
But it seems that there seems to me, at least, there's been a pattern with a couple of people. And I trust that you'll just keep an eye on that if you see. Well, in questions like, well, why you,
Exactly. Billy and Joe Smith. And that's one of the things we're looking at, trying to readjust schedules to accommodate those additional duties and take it out and try to backfill with per diems rather than, that stuff. Yeah. Also not allowing for any sort of overtime without prior management approval unless it's related to responding to emergencies. So these are all things that we're trying to drill down and really
fix. And I really appreciate Zach. But what we need to do is we do need to make some decisions on, when you project this out for next year, is it worth having some clerical support? Is it worth having another person on instead of having overtime? I mean, it's really important to track this and see if there's a way to reduce the cost.
The discussion
is more like we should be running it.
Yeah, the discussion's absolutely important to have. I will say, with our full-time staff, considering sick time, vacation time, and the hours that are still open, I have 3,000 hours a year that I have to fill with per diems, and a full-time person is 2,000 hours. A person and a half we're trying to fill with per diems, and I got some great per diems. I have 30 of them, and they pick up a lot of shifts. So,
And that's what we got to work with, is make those kind of decisions. So. I mean, on a $1 million budget, being $20,000 short on your payroll is not huge, but you know, it is problematic in the sense that we've been trending it. So, but I feel like you're doing corrective action and it should be effective in the next few. And it should get better.
Yeah.
Instead of even trending, you know, the shortfall is only trending as if it was the same, mm-hmm. you know, and hopefully it is getting better. So
yeah.
we should be okay, I think.
Okay, we have a motion made. We have a motion seconded.
Second.
All right, your motion for seconding. All those in favor of adjourning this wonderful meeting after 2 hours and 15 minutes, say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned at Zach at 8:17.